Welcome back to our official YouTube channel, SR and BGNR Government Degree College, Khammam. Myself, Dr. V. Satish Kumar, Assistant Professor in Biochemistry. We have been studying about the enzymology topics which are present in third semester of BSc Biochemistry, second year students. We completed Unit 3 pertaining to fundamentals of enzymes, and now we have studied about the regulation of enzymes and inhibition processes in last two classes. In the present video lesson, we are going to study the mechanism of enzymatic action. The previous class, we have discussed about the enzyme inhibitions, where we have seen three different modes of enzyme inhibition. First one is non-covalent. First one is reversible inhibition, where we have seen about two different modes of reversible inhibition. First one is competitive inhibition and second one is non-competitive inhibition. In the competitive inhibition, it is a reversible inhibition process. Substrate binds the active site with non-covalent interactions, and the same way the inhibitor also binds to the same active site with non-covalent interaction. So therefore, there is a competition between substrate and enzyme for the active site, that is called competitive inhibition. And in non-competitive inhibition, the substrate binds to the active site, but the inhibitor binds other than the active site with non-covalent interaction. Therefore, there is no competition between the substrate and inhibitor for the active site. That is why the Vmax changes, but not the Km. In case of competitive inhibition, the Km changes, but not the Vmax. And in case of irreversible inhibition, the inhibitor binds enzyme with covalent interactions. It binds to the active site by means of covalent interactions. So that is why it will be with the enzyme permanently. So therefore, we cannot take out the inhibitor from the active site of the enzyme. Once it binds the enzyme will be permanently impaired. Therefore, these irreversible inhibitors are known as toxic or poisonous substances. We have seen some of the examples like organophosphate insecticides, diisopropyl fluorophosphate, which already used as a Naru gas during World War II by Germans, and iodoacetate. These three examples we have covered so far as irreversible inhibitors, and after that the third one is allosteric inhibition. Actually, it is allosteric regulation. So there is activation as well as inhibition. In allosteric regulation, what happens, we will have specific allosteric activators and inhibitors which binds other than the active site, and if the activator binds to the allosteric site, the enzyme will be activated, and if the inhibitor binds to the same allosteric site, then the enzyme will be inhibited. So these enzymes are complex, and they will have more than one subunits. Some subunits are known as regulator subunits, and some for catalytic activity they are called as catalytic subunits. We will have two different forms for the allosteric enzyme. One is T form and another one is R form. R form stands for relaxed form, which is reactive form, and T is inhibited form. So in the previous class we have discussed all these things elaborately, and now today we are going to discuss about the mechanism of enzyme action. So how the enzymes really lower the activation energy of the reactants. Okay, so the enzyme definition itself explains that enzyme will lower the activation energy of reactants, thereby it increases the velocity of the reaction. So it reduces the activation energy. So in last few classes we have studied the basics of enzymology, where we have seen that activation energy will be lowered by the interaction between enzyme and substrate. So the substrate easily converted to its transition state, and transition state is converted to products. So the key for the increased velocity of enzyme is with reduction of activation energy. For a brief period, let us go back to the basics of enzyme action, and then we will continue with the different types of enzymatic mechanisms. So here the activation energy and the transition state. For any reaction to take place, the reactant or substrate here, the substrate must be first of all converted to a transition state, and then transition state is is converted to the product. So there is a transition state between reactant and the product. So this is the intermediate molecule between reactant and the product. In a non-catalyzed reaction, suppose this is a non-catalyzed reaction, the purple curve gives the non-catalyzed reaction, where the reactant should reach the transition state. For that it require a lot of amount of energy, and that energy is called the activation energy. So for a non-catalyzed reaction, the activation energy is more, and then it forms the product. So therefore here the products, the reactants never directly form product. If it forms a product directly without involving a transition state, then what happens is a spontaneous reaction takes place, because the reactants are having higher energy and the products are having always lower energy when compared with the reactants. So therefore this is downhill movement. In the downhill movement, what happens, there is no need of any assistance for this reaction. Therefore the reactants simply comes down and liberate energy and form the products. So we always will have products only, not the higher energy reactants. So therefore the reaction takes place spontaneously. But if we see in our nature, even though the reaction is exergonic reaction, still it doesn't happen on its own spontaneously. It requires a little bit of energy, then only it takes place. Suppose we have a can full of petrol, and if we burn the petrol, what happens? Energy will be released from the petrol. So the petrol is being converted to carbon dioxide and water. So in that reaction, lot of energy is being released. So the product, that is carbon dioxide and water, are having very less energy, but the reactant, the petrol, is having high energy molecules. But still that reaction doesn't take place spontaneously. We need at least a small spark to burn the petrol. So in the same way, without any activation energy, we cannot convert the reactants to product, even though the reactants energy are higher than the products. So that is why we have to use some energy, we have to put some energy, give some energy to the reactants, so they will reach the transition state, then only they will be converted to products. And in this course they will liberate the energy. So the difference between this energy and this energy will be the resulting energy. So if it is negative, then it is a exergonic reaction, or otherwise it is a endergonic reaction. So in this case, if we use the enzyme, what happens? Simply it lowers the activation energy, the transition state. In any way we are getting the transition state from the reactants, but the energy required by the reactants to reach the transition state will be lowered by the use of a catalyst or an enzyme. So therefore, less energy is required for the formation of transition state, and then from the transition state we will get the product. So this is the key for the effectivity or activity of the enzyme. So enzymes simply lowers the activation energy of the reactants, so that they will easily converted into transition state, and from transition state to products. So now we will discuss about the mechanisms, the different mechanisms which are adopted by the enzymes, which ultimately lowers the activation energy of reactants. So there are four different mechanisms by which the enzymes reduce the activation energy of reactants. So that four different mechanisms we are going to study now in this class. So here the formation of enzyme substrate complex is very crucial for the catalysis and product formation. So enzyme substrate complex formation, which is also known as a transition state. So formation of transition state or enzyme substrate complex is very crucial for the product formation. It is estimated that for any typical enzyme catalyzed reaction, the rate of the reaction will be 10 to the power of 6 to 10 to the power of 12 times faster than a non-catalyzed reaction. So we can easily understand how fast the enzymes are really. Enzymes are very, very accurate and very fast when compared with the non-enzymatic reaction. So 10 to the power of 6 to 10 to the power of 12 times faster means it is one million to 1 trillion times faster than a normal non-catalyzed reaction. So that much of speed and accuracy is there for the enzymes. That is only because of lowering the activation energy of reactants. So we have four different mechanisms. These four different mechanisms are adapted by different enzymes, which allow them to reduce the activation energy of reactants. So they are, first one is acid base catalysis, second one is covalent catalysis, third one is metal ion catalysis, and fourth one is electrostatic catalysis. We will discuss each and every mechanism separately. Let us start with the first one, that is acid base catalysis. In acid base catalysis, what happens here is, in the active site there will be some amino acid residues which acts as both acids and as well as bases based on their state. So for example histidine is there. Histidine is having two nitrogen atoms. So one nitrogen atom, if it accepts a proton by giving a lone pair of electrons to proton, it can accept a proton and form NH bond. So if it accept a proton, it is known as a base. The same way it can release the proton from the nitrogen, then it becomes the acid. So the same amino acid residue, first it is acting a accepting a proton from the substrate, and then it is again donating the same proton to the substrate. So in this course of this acid base reactions, the substrate will be converted to product. The transition state will be easily stabilized by the acid base mechanisms. So there are several different amino acids which are present in the active site of these enzymes, which acts as acid base catalytic residues. So here a base means a proton acceptor. So here you can see B stands for base, and we have lone pair of electrons, two dots. These lone pair of electrons easily given to a proton. So then what happens? B gives two electrons to H plus. Then we will get B bond H. So this way the B is giving, accepting, actually B is accepting proton and by donating electrons. So this B is now a base. In the same way, the BH plus, so that means the conjugate of acid, it donates the proton and acts as a acid. It acts as an acid. So let us easily understand this acid base catalysis mechanism by a simple example. Okay, so these are some of the enzymes, some of the amino acid residues which generally present in the active site of the enzymes which are involved in acid base catalytic mechanisms. Okay, so most of the acidic amino acids acts in the acid base catalysis. So we have glutamate and aspartate, so they acts as easily proton donors, they donate protons. And carboxylate, so their conjugate, the base form is carboxylate. So glutamic acid acts as a proton donor, and glutamate acts as a proton acceptor. So in the same way, lysine and arginine, they are having NH2 group. This N is having a lone pair of electron, therefore they can accept proton, or they can donate the proton also. So cysteine, we have having SH group. So yes, the sulfur is also having lone pair of electron. And histidine, the most important example in the acid base catalysis is histidine amino acid residue, because we have two amino groups here, two NH groups is two nitrogens in the ring structure. So one acts as a base and another acts as a acid. So simultaneously within the same amino acid residue, basic nature is there and acidic nature is there. So therefore it is a potential acid base amino acid residue. And in the same way, like cysteine, we have serine here, and tyrosine is also having the OH group. So that is why it is also a residue involved in acid base catalysis. So let us look at an example to explain the acid base catalysis mechanism. Here, in fact, this chymotrypsin is a proteolytic enzyme in the digestive system which breaks the polypeptide chains, proteins, into peptides. Okay, In the active site of chymotrypsin, we have histidine residue and serine residue. Okay, so here what happens? This histidine is having B plus. B plus means here the nitrogen. Say for example, the nitrogen is there. The nitrogen is having lone pair of electron. So that nitrogen, one of the nitrogen acts as base. So that nitrogen donates the lone pair of electrons to the proton present on the serine. So serine, on the serine we have OH side chain, CH2OH side chain, and in the OH, so here the nitrogen on the histidine accept a proton from the serine. So therefore we are now what happens, the proton will be shifted from serine to histidine. So we have protonated form of histidine, and now serine is having O minus because it lost the proton O minus. So now that O minus attacks on the carboxy carbon of a polypeptide chain, thereby it will donate the electrons to carboxy carbon, and the electrons between nitrogen and carbon will be shifted onto the nitrogen. So now the bond breaks here, then the amino acid, the chain which is having the C double bond O, will be shifted to the serine, and remaining portion will be released. Okay, so that means the negative charge on the O, the oxygen, that is involved in the splitting of peptide bond in the polypeptide chain by forming a bond with the carboxy carbon in the peptide bond. So the oxygen is in O minus form, that is forming a covalent bond with the carboxy carbon. Therefore the bond between the nitrogen and carbon will be split in, and this total molecule will be now interacted with the serine. And in the next case, once again this H plus comes back and interact with the O, then what happens, the bond between the O and C double C will be broken down, and it releases this peptide chain, broken peptide chain. So what happens here, simply the base is accepting a proton and creating a negative charge in the on the oxygen of serine amino acid residue, and that is splitting the polypeptide chain into two parts, and once again the proton is going back to the serine. Therefore from the serine the fragment of polypeptide chain will be liberated. So here two things are there. First one is acid base catalysis by the histidine, and second one is the serine is involving in the bond formation with the substrate. Okay, these two mechanisms are being followed by the chymotrypsin. So therefore the acid base catalysis plays a important role in the formation of transition states, thereby decreasing the activation energy and fastening the velocity of enzymatic reaction. And the second mechanism is covalent catalysis. In fact, we have discussed in the earlier example about the covalent catalysis also. So in covalent catalysis, a covalent bond will be formed between the amino acid residue in the active site and the substrate molecule itself. So therefore, a covalent bond will be formed between these two. So because of the covalent bond, the activation energy is decreased and the product will be formed easily. So in case of chymotrypsin, we have seen that in case of chymotrypsin, what happens? Serine is involving in the covalent catalysis. So covalent catalysis, the serine is interacting with the amino acid substrate with a covalent bond between the covalent bond between the serine oxygen and the carboxycarbon of the broken polypeptide chain. Okay, this is called a covalent catalysis mechanism. So here the chymotrypsin utilizing both mechanisms. One is acid base catalysis mechanism by using histidine, and second one is covalent catalysis mechanism by using serine residue in the active site. So in the covalent catalysis, the negatively charged or positively charged groups or sites will be present on the active site of the enzyme. In case of chymotrypsin, we are having O minus group on the serine residue. So that is a negatively charged that acts as a nucleophile because it is having more electron density on the oxygen. So those electrons attack on the carbonyl carbon of the polypeptide chain and breaks the peptide bond. Okay, therefore the amino acid residues in the active site of these enzymes sometimes may have a positive charge or sometimes may have a negative charge. In both the cases, they will form a permanent covalent bond between the substrate and themselves. So that is covalent bond formation. So the examples for covalent catalysis are serine proteases. So chymotrypsin, trypsin, thrombin, all these enzymes and proteins comes under the category of serine proteases because they hydrolyze proteins they will have serine amino acid residue in the active site. They play a major role in the proteolytic cleavage. So therefore they are called as serine proteases. Earlier we had one more example like pepain, which is a cysteine protease which has SH group instead of OH group. Okay, so these are called serine proteases. And the third mechanism of enzyme action is metal ion catalysis. So in some cases, some of the enzymes binds metal ions in their active site. So those metal ions always will have positive charges. Because of their positive charge, they interact with the negative charges on substrate and they will form ionic bonds between that positive charge and a negative charge, so that the substrate and the transient state will be stabilized during the course of enzymatic reaction. So the main mechanism by the metal ion catalysis is by stabilizing the negative charges through the metal ions. Based on the metal ions present in proteins and enzymes, the enzymes are classified into two different types. First one is metalloenzyme. Metalloenzyme contains a tightly bound transient state metal ion. Tightly bound.